Welcome to another episode of the African Europe Insight by the Sunny Ofehe Show. In this episode, we take a look at the Tompolo Foundation with in-depth emphasis on the Okerenkoko Cottage Hospital in Delta State, which started operation in April 2013. The hospital currently serves patients from Delta, Edo, and Ondo states, all of the Niger Delta. The Okerenkoko Cottage Hospital is run by the Tompolo Foundation. And once again, we're in the community Okerenkoko in Gbaramatu local government area, where we have chief government Ekwempolo, popularly known as Tompolo. We're here to actually look at the community, look at the lives of the ordinary people, look at how they have lived in an environment that is blessed with crude oil, and also most importantly to look at what he has done to showcase this community in the world map. We understand that there is a lot of projects going on here. They have Marine University and they have a lot of things that have actually brought relief to the people of this community. So we're here to actually follow this process.
It was built by the Niger Delta Development Commission, NDDC. They just built the structure and ends there. Then when the Delta State Oil Producing Areas Development Commission was established, that is the Tupadek, it now came to put some medical equipment and brought staff to run it. And that actually lasted for about 3 years. It ends 2009, during the invasion of Gbaramatu Kingdom, including this community. So it was abandoned. At a point, it was overgrown by weeds, reptiles were everywhere. But not because of the health need of the people. Tompolo Foundation came in, renovated the whole place, brought in equipment, brought in staff, and specifically April 2nd, 2013, we started operation in this place. And since then, the foundation has been running this place free of charge.
For the people of the community.
For the people of community and neighboring communities. In fact, people from this community is in Wari Southwest, no government area. But people from neighboring no government areas like Brutu, Wari North, even as far as Edo and Ondo states, come here, yes, for treatment. There are people from even Wari Urban come here because of the nature of the place, free of charge. And the attention that is given to people here has no comparison in terms of health delivery in our terrain here. So people come here.
So if you want to ask for international collaboration, for instance, like international NGOs that are known to support, the healthcare is part of the Millennium Development Goal, what will you specifically say are the needs of this hospital?
Well, specifically, we need state-of-the-art equipment, medical equipment, also drugs. And maybe some other auxiliary needs, but basically equipment, we need beds, two beds, we need drugs, because drugs are things that are consumed daily basis.
Yeah. So
we may even need some assistance to pay stipend for the study staff. Yes.
And how do they get training? Has there been any arrangement for staff training?
Exactly.
As doctors, sometimes you want to meet up with.
Exactly. There should be area of training too, but we are doing our little best here.
How many bed hospital?
14 bed hospital.
Okay. So
we'll
just.
We'll go in and see.
Is there going to be doctor available?
Yes.
Doctor Jomoni.
So you take us around.
This is the patient. Mm. Let's present her. Yeah. Then you also use this as part of a female for the children. This is the nursing station. When we have new patients coming, this is where we observe them, take their vital signs. Consulting room. This is the consulting room one. Okay. Then the other consulting room is just adjacent to this one. Then these are examining couch.
This is a theater.
This is a theater. We do series of operations there, ranging from lacoma excisions. We've done a couple of myomectomy here. We've done a couple of hyenography, hydroselectomy, various surgeries that come. We do them here in this operating room. And we also there we do most times. Sometimes they come with retained products of conception, probably after attempted termination of pregnancy. So if we have cases like that, we do evacuation of retained products of conception using that pouch over there.
So what would you say is the challenge of this current theater room? If you want to ask for international help, what will you need? What kind of support will you need for this?
Presently, our ventilator is not working very well, so we don't use it for what we do GA, general anesthesia. So we will need a ventilator. Our oxygen supply at the moment is limited. We use oxygen concentrator, but we are having challenges with the functionality of the oxygen concentrator. So we need some oxygen concentrator and also oxygen supply with cylinder, so we can give them intranasal oxygen during surgery. And then some other emergency for endotracheal intubation. Like he said, we want to be going for training, especially for airway management. You know, sometimes we may need to intubate patients, and we need endotracheal tubes, we need ventilators, you know, to help us handle cases properly. And then if the medical team can be sent for airway management, if it could be sponsored by international organization, it will also help us, especially cardiopulmonary resuscitation, advanced basic life support for the doctors. Anemia is a very, very common problem here because of malnutrition and severe malaria, especially for children. So when we have children coming with PCV of 8%, 10%, 12%, and we need to transfuse, it's always very difficult, you know, getting blood, and they present very late at night. You know, so that's one of the problems we are having. Although the blood bank is functional, we could store blood for up to a month there, but we also have a problem of power supply. You know, the community light is not always available. So sometimes when we store blood there within a week, because of interruption with the power supply, we usually the blood will just get damaged. So we're having that challenge with respect to the blood bank.
So the kind of medical equipment that you can get anywhere in the best place in the world.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have them now. So this is where this place is meant for.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So by the time they are installed, yeah, believe me, it's it will be one of the best places you can do
any
laboratory investigation in the whole of the state.
Okay.
In the whole of the state. You can hardly have any lab where you have the kind of complete medical equipment you want to install in this state, in the whole of the state.
Okay.
Except maybe for Chevron or Shepherd.
Mm-hmm.
So for now, this is the lab.
Okay. Mm-hmm. A microscope. We have three centrifuges, this and this one. Two microscopes. Our incubator for culture sensitivity. The blood bank. We have a blood bank. Okay. Yeah. Essentially, the blood bank is functioning well. We have an average of 2-3 deliveries every week, and mostly complicated delivery, but so far we've been doing well. We've not had any mortality during the childbirth, no perinatal death either. So these are labor ward where we take the normal vaginal deliveries.
Generators. This one is a diesel generator. Then we have another smaller generator. This other one, we is a fuel petrol, generator.
Mm-hmm.
We usually shuttle between the two. We alternate them.
Okay.
You know, and I told you about power problem not long ago. The major problem we have with power is fueling. You know, buying diesel and the generator, fueling it for 24 hours is usually very, very difficult. This one consumes an average of 30 liters in 12 hours. This one about the same thing too. You know, and that is
so you have to only rely on the generator?
Yes, most of the time we rely on the generator. Occasionally, the community light comes on in the evening, but occasionally, it's not very consistent. Okay. So we rely more on the two generators we have here. We have a borehole here that supplies us water. Mm. The challenge we have is with purification. We've tried to purify the water, but it's not pure. So we cannot even use it for our hospital work. We can't use it to, you know, autoclave our equipment because despite all the efforts at cleansing the water, we just couldn't achieve proper purification. So I believe if we can get support from international organizations in terms of purification, it will do us a lot of good for us to have very good water to run the hospital. We have different classes of drugs, ranging from anti-malaria, because that's the commonest problem in this environment, to antibiotics. We have both parenteral and oral medication. We have anti-hypertensive, anti-malaria over here, some of the antibiotics for children, analgesics. We have several anti-hypertensive and anti-diabetic drugs as well. Over here are some of our emergency drugs, atropine, epinephrine. Even our anesthetic medications are also here as well. We have intravenous drugs, infusion, different infusions, intravenous fluids as well. You know, topical agents, syringes. These are pharmacy.
So how do you get regular supply of this?
So far, the foundation has been fully in charge of provision of drugs for us, and the drugs are dispensed free of charge, no cost at all to the patients, irrespective of the medication, admission free of charge. There is no cost.
Yeah. Okay. So this is the main ward.
This is the main ward. Essentially, where the foundation is looking at expanding the clinic. We have our living quarters behind there, if they can convert them to wards. Mm. But then before they can do that, we need a quarter for the staff. You know, just at the back of the clinic, there's an available land at the back of the clinic. So if there's any support with respect to giving us an alternative accommodation, then we can look at expanding the center to that area, maybe increase the number of beds to about 30. Okay.
So invariably, this cottage hospital serves, because he mentioned it, but I also want to hear from you, serves people beyond
this community. Yes.
And the means of coming is through speedboat. That's the only way you can access it.
Yes. Okay. Then we also have the challenge of an ambulance. We need a boat ambulance because there are times where we need to refer patients in the middle of the night, you know, and getting transportation is a major problem. So if we have an ambulance, you know, stationed at the boat ambulance, even in the middle of the night, we can always get a boat driver that will take them down to the tertiary center for immediate care.
Okay.
That's another major challenge that we have.
Okay.
The communication as well. The community, there's no network coverage. Yes.
No network at all.
No network coverage. It's difficult getting a network. Just waiting and constant and off.
So then it's difficult to communicate. Like if you want to refer.
Yes, if we have to call, we send somebody over to worry. You know, it's difficult reaching out to. So that's one of the few challenges. One of the challenges we're having as well.
Okay.
The foundation provides water for us. Don't worry. No, when it rains, we can use this for do laundry, you know, bathe. But aside that, for drinking and cooking water, the foundation buys water, supplies us water from Wari because they couldn't purify the borehole.
Dispensing.
Yeah, sometimes we use the dispenser. No, it's the water dispenser, but it's bad at the moment.
Okay.
Well, so that would be pain. All this my neck, they pain me.
So this is how they just come sometimes? Okay. So they get free Medicare?
So how were
the people of this community coping when this hospital was not here?
In fact, it was a terrible thing because what happened was that there was a particular day the chairman and founder of Tompolo Foundation, I Chief Governor Tompolo, called me that we cannot longer bear this thing, that two children just died, that there's a need for us to come in and do something. So it was a daily basis issue that people died. Because for you to now transport somebody to the nearest place, of course, is worrying. The person will die on the way. So it was a very terrible thing. Yeah.
Just saw a patient just came in from the church feeling sick and now lying on the bed. How do you normally respond to such?
When we have such cases rushed in like that, the first thing we just an initial assessment of what the possible cause could be. You know, once we're able to establish the cause of collapse, in cases like that, we'll intervene immediately with the appropriate management plan. A case, for instance, I don't forget, was a little child that was rushed from a neighboring village. It was a very cold evening, you know, so the child was, he's been playing outside in the water. So all of a sudden, the child became very, very cold, but the parents didn't know what was wrong. The child just collapsed. They rushed the child, carried the child in a boat, and then on a speedboat. So they even worsened the hypothermia, the cold temperature that the child was suffering from. By the time the child got here, the child was in coma, full, complete coma, was unresponsive. When we quickly checked the temperature, touched the body, we felt the coldness. All we did was provide warmth for the child. You know, over time, the child picked up, and the child went home without any, you know, high medication. So that's basically how we respond. We also had the child who came in severe shock.
So if this hospital was not here, of course, the child would have been dead.
It would have been dead. We had another case that I won't forget. That one was in severe shock. Was in shock. It was no longer producing urine from diarrhea and vomiting. You know, the mother didn't present in time. By the time they got here, the child was in severe shock. You know, luckily for us, we were able to secure an IV, get IV access immediately. So we hydrated with our infusion, and within 2 days, the child picked up fully, and the mother went home. You know, so if not for this center, that one would have been gone as well, because it was almost an imminent organ failure at the time we presented.
So it has become imperative now that the center needs more support to be able to stretch their support to reach out to more people.
Yes, definitely.
Thank you very much.
Pleasure.
Yeah. Can you tell our viewers who you are and what you do in relation to the Tompolo Foundation?
I am Dr. Gaha Klasse. I am the director of the Tompolo Foundation.
Doctor by profession?
Yes, I'm a medical doctor. Okay.
Can you just give us a bit of a historical background about this cottage hospital, how it came into existence?
Yeah, the cottage hospital was built by the Niger Delta Development Commission. It was just only the building. It was neither equipped nor staffed. But when the Delta State Health Commission was set up, the hospital was equipped and staffed by the Delta State. And it ran until 2009. And I guess that was done free of charge. So they were offering the people free medical care. Okay. And as a result of the nature of the topography of this area, so they were doing that, and they did that for 3 years until the invasion of Gbaramatu by the JTF in 2009. So invariably, the cottage hospital was abandoned in 2009 after the invasion of Gbaramatu by the joint military force.
And the Tompolo Foundation took it over.
Yes.
And they've been running it since then till now?
Yes, the Tompolo Foundation took over from there. Because this was done by the founder of the foundation, also known as Tompolo, because of the deep passion he has for his people. There were almost daily deaths recorded in this community and the surrounding community. And this place was abandoned. So he was moved with compassion and he came in. Because he couldn't stand the sight of his people dying almost on a daily basis. because of the absence of healthcare or health facility. Because for you to access the nearest health facility to this place, we take you almost about 1 hour 30 minutes.
Well, let us understand the location of this community. This is supposed to be an oil-bearing community, isn't it? Because we saw a lot of oil wells when we were coming to this community. Are there no multinational oil companies present? If yes, who are those multinational oil companies drilling oil in this community?
Yes, thank you very much. Yes, there are. Chevron is one of them. And even Shell too, before Shell relocated.
Okay, Shell was here.
Shell was here. But you agree with me because of the greediness and the hypocrisy involved as well with this person. So most of the communities around, and especially local community, was neglected. So that is one of the challenges we've been having as a people, and of course, which part of the reason the agitation was so high at that point in time, where the people were calling for government to attract government presence. You agree with me? We have been the egg playing the golden, and so the chicken laying the golden, but we've not been benefiting. So that's part from part of the cross of the agitation at that point in time.
A lot of the staff that we spoke to were mentioning Tompolo. Who is Tompolo to you? I mean, in terms of what he has done to the people of this community.
I wish I had words enough to describe Tompolo. Okay. He's a father to every Gbaramatu person. This thing he's doing, he's not just doing it, he's not just taking care of the health needs of the people, he's as well taking care of the educational needs of the people. And he's doing it from his own personal pocket. There's no kind of support from anywhere or from anybody. So to me personally, and to a lot of Gbaramatu individuals, he's not just a hero, he's a father.
What is your message to international organizations, NGOs, who normally support cottage hospitals in remote communities around the world? What would be your message to them, putting this in mind?
Yes. I want to cry out to them to come out and support the good work Ashegome Ekwepolo is doing. He's a man that has been doing it on his own, from his own personal pocket. Okay, so the more reason he needs the support of international organizations and NGOs who share his ideology and passion in this regard. So we're calling out to them. They should come and to please come in the aid of Ashegome Ekwepolo to sustain what is presently doing for his people.
Finally, we're back to Warri, where we started our journey from. I mean, having been to your community, having seen what we've seen, how do you feel now coming back?
Well, first and foremost, I want to thank you for this opportunity you avail us to go and see things for yourself, what's happening in our community, and also to thank God for the journey mercies you give to us. Well, sincerely speaking, things like this should be taken serious by the international community and whoever that's going to watch this program, because it's the truth, nothing but the truth. It is what our people are going through, that such things normally agitate their mind, and they will begin to want to make trouble. But by the time when the government will do the needful, and also the multinationals will be able to carry out their corporate responsibility, there will be peace for everybody to be able to, you know, to live on. Yes, that is it.
Doctor?
That we are receptive people. We accept visitors wholeheartedly, and at any time we are looking towards, you know, welcoming them to our area for investment and any business that they can do. Yes.
Doctor, do you have anything to add?
The government and the multinationals, every one of us, every one of them should just be able to their responsibility, and especially the multinational that operates around here. Even if it is just 2% of the percentage they allocate for corporate social responsibility, even if they devote that 2%
to genuine
cause, as it affects our people,
yes.
Okay, there wouldn't be much trouble, so to speak. Okay, so they should live up, they should wake up to the corporate social responsibility, so life can be more meaningful to the people.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Finally, we're here back to the destination where we started our journey from, and we've been able to see the community, we've been able to see the cottage hospital, we've been able to see the challenges through the same amount of the people themselves, and hopefully, if you're viewing me right now, I want to tell you that the people of the Niger Delta, most especially those who live in the creek, really need your help. Do something. We must put pressure on the multinational oil companies, the Nigerian government, and of course every institution, NGO, civil society organization, to do something so that the people of this community can live a more peaceful life. Thank you for having us.